Hello everyone. In Constitutional Law 2, Unit 2 syllabus, we are going to discuss some of the very important topics. For example, the two organs, the two main organs of the government, that is executive and the legislature. So in the executive, we are going to discuss about the executive power of the government at the central and the state level. The head of the executive, that is president, governor, their powers, functions, and also we are going to study about the parliament and the state. And in the second organ of the government, that is legislature, we are going to study about the concepts related to the bicameralism, the composition of the parliament, powers and functions of the parliament, council of ministers, their collective responsibility, and we are also going to discuss about the position of prime minister and chief minister. So let us have a detailed discussion on these particular topics, which is very, very important from the point of understanding as well as from the point of examination. So before directly moving on to this syllabus, we have to generally have a discussion on the structure of the Indian government. We have already studied in our first unit that the federal features of the Indian government. India, it looks like a federal, but it functions like a unitary government. That is the reason we call the Indian government as quasi-federal in nature. But still, there is a distribution of power between the center and the state government. And these two state governments, the structure of these two governments are somewhat similar. The structure of the government of India is based on the three important wings of the government, or we also call it as the three important organs of the government, namely executive, legislature, and judiciary. We have also adopted the doctrine of separation of theory principle. Based on that, each organ of the government, that is executive, legislature, judiciary, is having a different nature of powers and the duties to be exercised. So we are very much familiar with the main functions of this government or the organs of the government. If we take the example, the legislature being the first wing of the government, the main duty of the legislature is to enact the laws or to make the laws. Another very important function of the second organ of the government is executive. The main function of the executive is to execute the laws which are made by the legislature. And the third and the very, very important organ of the government is judiciary. The main duty of the judiciary is interpretation of the laws. It is the protector of the constitution, protector of the fundamental rights that are guaranteed in the constitution, and also it is the interpreter of the laws which are made by the legislature. So the structure of the government of India, both at the central and at the state level, it comprises with the three important organs of the government, that is executive, legislature, and judiciary. So according to your syllabus, we are going to start firstly with the very important organ of the government, that is executive. As you all know, the main duty of the executive wing of the government or the executive organ of the government is to implement the laws or to execute the laws which are made by the legislature. So, the executive organ of the government, we have it in the union or the central level, and also we have it at the state level. So, in the union level, the executive organ of the government comprises with at the very, very top or at the hierarchy level, the president stands at top, followed by the vice president and along with the council of ministers. The council of ministers, whose head is none other than prime minister. And coming to the state government also, as I told you, the state government also have the three important organs of the government. Like that, the state executive organ of the government also comprises with the governor at the top level and followed by the council of minister, and this council of ministers, whose head is none other than the chief minister of the respective states. So with this particular background, let us analyze the executive organ of the government provisions in detail. So coming to the very important aspect is the union executive. A point to be noted here, part 5 of the Indian constitution, from articles 52 to 78 and article 123 of the constitution, deals with the provisions relating to union executive or the central executive. Before directly moving on to these provisions in detail, we have to analyze this particular principle called the parliamentary form of government. You are very much aware that one of the very, very important feature of the Indian constitution is the parliamentary form of government. So under the parliamentary form of government, we all know that the Constitution of India establishes the parliamentary form of government both at the center and the state level. So the Constitution which establishes the parliamentary form of government, it is the essence of the government that the parliamentary type of government, the head of the state is the constitutional head, and the real executive powers are vested in the Council of Ministers. As I told you, at the union level, the executive organ of the government, it is not a presidential form of government like United States of America. India has established or adopted the parliamentary form of government. One of the very essence of the parliamentary type of government is that the head of the state or the country or the nation is the constitutional head of the executive organ of the government. So, the executive powers are vested with the Council of Ministers, and the Prime Minister of India is the head of the Council of Ministers. The Council of Ministers, along with the Prime Minister of India, is responsible or answerable to the House of the People. You all know there are two houses of the Parliament. One is Lok Sabha and the another one is Rajya Sabha. Lok Sabha is also called as lower house of the Parliament, and in another word we also call it as House of the People. So, the Council of Ministers, along with the Prime Minister of India, is responsible to the House of the People. They are answerable to the Lok Sabha, or they are answerable to the House of the People. So, though the executive power is vested in the President of India, but the President of India exercises this power only with the aid and advices given by the Council of Ministers. So this members of the Council of Ministers are elected by the people, and they are the members of the legislatures. The members of the legislatures, that is members of the parliament also we can call it as, that is both the members of both the houses of the parliament, that is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. So based on this particular background, we are going to discuss about the union executive head, that is the President of India. The President of India, as you all know, the first citizen of the country. The President of India is the head of the country. Especially in our political system, the President of India exercises only nominal
powers. Nominal power in the sense he exercises only very less power in practical. The President of India is similar or is like the Queen of Britain, whose functions are to a large extent is ceremonial in nature. The President of India is having the power to supervise the overall functions of all the political institutions in the country. So therefore, the President of India, even though he is the head of the executive organ of the government, he cannot exercise his independent powers. He cannot exercise his discretionary power. He must act only according to the aid and advices given by the Council of Ministers, whose head is none other than the Prime Minister of India. So, the Constitution of India has given this or placed the President in the highest position because he is the constitutional head of the country. So with this introduction about the President of India, let us discuss the constitutional provisions relating to the President of India. Article 52 of the Constitution says that there shall be a President of India. He is the head of the state. So as per the provisions, the President of India is the head of the state, and Article 52 clearly says that there shall be a President of India who will be the head of the state. Here, head in the sense the country or the nation. Further, under Article 53 of the Constitution, it says that the executive power of the central government or the union government shall be vested in the President. I read, the Article 53 says that the executive power of the union shall be vested in President, and it shall be exercised by him in accordance with the Constitution, either directly or through officers subordinate to him. So here, if we analyze the provisions of Article 53 of the Constitution, it says that the executive power of the central government is given in the hand of the President of India. It is vested in the President of India. The President of India can exercise these powers in accordance with the Constitution. The executive power which is given to the President of India, he can exercise this power only according to the provisions of the Constitution. That is, either he can directly exercise or he can exercise this executive power through Constitution only through the officers subordinate to him. Here, officers subordinate to him includes the members of the parliament also. Either he can directly exercise this executive power or he can get the works done by his subordinate officers, who is none other, it can be the members of parliament, that is members of Lok Sabha or the members of Rajya Sabha also. So, according to the provisions of Article 52 and 53, which exclusively deals with there shall be a President of India and who is the head of the state. Further, under Article 53 of the Constitution, it clearly says the executive power of the union government or the central government is vested in the hand of the President of India. But you have to keep it in mind that the President of India is only a nominal head. His powers are very less. He must act according to the aid and advices given by the Council of Ministers. So, this is a just brief introduction about the executive structure of the government and also the brief introduction about the President of India as per the provisions of Article 52 and 53 of the Constitution. In the next video, we were going to discuss about the other very important aspects relating to the President of India regarding his qualifications, his conditions of the office, his emoluments, and also we are going to discuss about the elections of the president, the method of voting in the elections of the president, and some other very important topics which we are going to discuss in our next video. Thank you.